Good morning. Isn't it good to be back together in the house of the Lord with all our fellow Christians? So good to see you this morning. Our prelude music this morning reminded us that we need to give thanks, and we're approaching the season where we especially think of that. But we want to always be thankful to our God, and we want to always offer our praise. We're going to begin with a song, a very familiar song, that offers praise. So I hope it turns your hearts upward as we sing, "How Great Thou Art." Let's be standing as we sing. You may be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to Park Plaza. We've got a full house this morning. We are so thankful that you're here, and thank you for helping us to accommodate getting everybody seated. It's good to have you here this morning. Wanted to call your attention to just a few announcements and some prayer requests. Actually, a lot of announcements and some prayer requests. Also, Christmas at the Plaza is getting close. We packed out two of our performances, and so we've added a third one. That'll be at daytime. I know so that helps some people who have a hard time driving at night, and that is listed there Saturday, December 10th at 2 o'clock. So those tickets are still at the nursery. They're free, but we just want to make sure that we have enough seats for everybody as they come. Our prayer items: American Rehabilitation Ministry is our mission prayer focus, so do be in prayer for them. Would you bow with them as we open this morning? Heavenly Father, we are thankful to be here today in this season of Thanksgiving. We're reminded of all the many ways in which you have blessed us so richly this past year, both in our families and as a church family. Father, we are thankful today for American Rehabilitation Ministry. We thank you for the good work that they have done for so many years in reaching those in our prison systems around the country. We pray this morning for Mark as he teaches us and leads us through the study of your word. We're thankful that the group has returned home safely from Israel. Pray that you will speak through him this morning. Open our hearts and minds. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We'd like to use our music this morning as a tool, which we try every week, tool to turn your thoughts away from things going on in this world, but thoughts of what we want you to focus on. Today, that tool is just to help us turn our thoughts in praise and worship. So all of our songs will be songs of worship to God, and hopefully they will help you as we continue through our service. I want to read a passage of scripture from the Psalms. Just to get us going and to make our thoughts turn toward heaven, turn toward the Lord in worship. This is Psalm 86, beginning with verse 9. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, O Lord. They will bring glory to your name, for you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. I will praise you, O Lord, my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever. Let's begin our medley of songs with the hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy. So many things that make him worthy of our praise, of our worship. But we are especially grateful as we remember what he's done for us in providing a way for our salvation in the gift of his son. We have several visitors today, and so I want to explain a little bit how we partake of the Lord's Supper here. We have people from out of town, people visiting family, and some just visiting here in town that we're glad you're here. All Christians are welcome as we share in the Lord's Supper. This is the time Jesus asked his followers to remember him through partaking of the emblems of the Lord's Supper. After we sing a song that again helps focus our attention on this special time, we will have a meditation and a prayer, and then the trays will be passed. The first tray you see has cups in it, but it's just bread in the cup, and that way it's individual pieces of bread in each cup. Take that and place the cup back in the tray and pass it on. Then the second tray will come, and it will have the fruit of the vine in it that we'll partake, put the cup back in the tray, and pass it on. That's just the way we found for right now that it makes things more convenient and still safer as we're still trying to be a little cautious with the situation in the world. We're going to sing a song that talks about the grace of God, and that's how we know his love for us, given to us on Calvary, because of his grace, the forgiveness that we receive, not of anything we do, but what he was doing for us out of his grace. Let's sing that song, Grace That Is Greater Than All the Sin We Have.
Our oldest granddaughter, Kelsey, when she was just a little bitty toddler, a little bitty thing, would come and spend a week at a time with us in Kansas City. And we would go and do things, and that continued throughout the years as she grew up. She and her sister would come and spend a great bit of time with us up there. And Kelsey would always say, "Remember, Papa? Remember when we did this, Papa? Remember when we did that, Papa? Remember, Papa?" Well, Kelsey is now 21 years old and married, but she still asks me from time to time if I remember something that we did in the past, only she doesn't say, "Remember, Papa," anymore. She's grown up. She says, "Papa, do you remember the time?" Memories are of the past events and special things in our life are important. And we need to remember those things and think on those things and relive those things in our heart. But it seems like the older we get, the harder it is to do that. Age kind of takes a toll on us, on our memory. Life gets busy and the cares of the world begin to drown in on us or flood in on us. And we tend to forget or at least push it back in our memories. As we think about these things, sometimes we need somebody to remind us, something to remind us to bring them back up. As his last night with the disciples, Jesus knew exactly what was coming for him. He knew the crucifixion and the horrible beating he would take and all of those things. But before he was arrested, before he was crucified, he did one thing for us. He left us the Lord's Supper to remember his great sacrifice for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26 read like this. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread and broke it, and took bread and gave thanks, and then he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and you, sealed with the shedding of my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus asks us today, do you remember my death for your sins? Do you remember my suffering and the great sacrifice I gave for you? Do you remember how much I love you? The old hymn says it like this, "Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary." Let's pray. Dear Lord, lead us to Calvary in this moment. Right now, Father, speak to our hearts, draw us close to the cross. Help us to remember your sacrifice for our sin and the eternal life we have through your blood. Thank you for being our Savior. Amen.
When the winds start to roar and the rains begin to pour, in the storm I'll call his name. He knows just what I'm praying for. Quietly he brings comfort to my soul. His calm is what I need, his presence to behold. Oh, in the midst of my storm, peace in the midst of my storm. I pray to him for comfort, but he gives me so much more, and I find peace in the midst of my storms. When tomorrow comes, if it will, my heart with joy will fill. No longer will I fear, even when those storm clouds appear. In Him I am assured, and I know I can endure. Peace comes to my mind through prayer. I know I can find all peace in the midst of my storms. Peace in the midst of my storms. I pray to Him for comfort, gives me so much more. I find peace in the midst of my storms. All peace in the midst of my storms.
Have you ever envisioned yourself walking with, perhaps talking to Jesus in your mind? Just walking along, following, perhaps listening? I have a lot. Been a little more difficult to get Him to talk to me, but there will come a day and we will meet face to face. I'm looking forward to that. Let's pray. Father, You sent Jesus just at the right time. We were able to observe Him. John says we observed Him in a special way so that we might get to know Him. And of course, that's been the intent all along, that we get to know Him. That's why we're here. So we certainly want to open our minds and our hearts right now as Brother Mark delivers a message. And we continue our battles here in Babylon, hoping and waiting for Your return. So we just thank You, Father, for what You've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Mike. I've never heard that song before. I'm sure glad I heard it this morning. Thank you, Don, for your prayer. It's wonderful to be back. Our trip to Israel was a great trip and a grueling trip. We were getting up at 5 each day, eating breakfast at 6, on the bus by 7, and we went pretty hard all day. 18 people from Park Plaza were part of this trip, 29 from the greater Joplin area, and 45 all total. Maybe you heard the news that 11 of us got delayed a day thanks to American Airlines. And we were kind of called ourselves the 11 late disciples. We were pretty sure that Judas worked as a mechanic for American Airlines. But anyway, we are glad to be back, and we'll be sharing about that next Sunday night. But I certainly want to begin today by thanking those who helped fill the gap while we were gone. So I want to thank my friend Terry Boland for his wonderful sermon on Romans 14, probably the clearest presentation of that I think I've ever heard. I listened to it online after I got back. And Greg Hafer did such a great job of coming alongside last week, our series from 1 Peter, from the book of Hebrews chapter 11. It was just marvelous. And of course, B.A. and David for filling the pulpit in the Sunday evening services. And for Keith Stammer for leading our music and worship. It's just good to know that we can go away and the church is in such capable hands. But we are glad to be back and glad to share with you in this final message in our series from 1 Peter today. Next Sunday, we'll do kind of a standalone Thanksgiving type message. And then we will head directly into the Advent season, into the Christmas season, with a series of messages in that regard. But let me start with this statement this morning. You've probably heard it. It's kind of a popular secular proverb that we need to hold our friends close and we need to hold our enemies closer. Yeah, believers should not be naive about their enemies even. And so it is that we have to have in our lives a spirit of, for lack of a better word today, watchfulness. We need to kind of wake up and smell the coffee. We have to watch our friends indeed, and we have to watch our enemies maybe even more. I have changed the title for today's sermon from the one that you see in your bulletin. Yes, we're going to talk about leadership. You can't talk about 1 Peter 5 and not talk about leadership. And yet, I think there's a bigger theme around the first 11 verses, and so I'm choosing to call it the idea of watchfulness, the exiles' watchfulness. While we live in this culture that's so separated from God that we are calling Babylon, we need to have a spirit of watchfulness. Now, one way to do that is to get a high enough perspective so you can see the landscape that's out there and get above the riffraff of daily life. Well, those of us that had the chance to go to the Holy Land ended up at what was called the Herodian. I had not been there for 22 years. I was glad to go back. This is a mountaintop, kind of flattened off, where King Herod the Great built a palace, built a fortress, so he could see his friends, both of them, and so that he could see mostly his enemies. And I want to show you a 1-minute and 6-second video that our son Casey took while on top there. And so you take a look from the Herodian, just a little south and east of Bethlehem as you would go toward the Dead Sea.
Okay, check this out. I am on top of the Herodian. And yeah, I'm breathing hard. It's a bit of a climb, but you can see why. This was Herod's palace slash fortress. King Herod, so the King Herod who wanted to kill the baby Jesus. That's him, all right? And you can see behind me here, it's a giant circular tower. You can see down in there, came up through this cut that it's kind of excavated out of the side of the mountain. Let me take you around. You got to look at this. Herod built this so that he could see his entire realm from here. And he could see watchtowers that were spread out around the land of Judea from this place. So let me spin you around here and you can see the central tower in the keep. Let's see here how we do this.
Well, the kid always did have a flair for the dramatic, I must say. But you can see as he kind of walked around the top of that and let his phone camera look, that it's pretty much, you could see all of Israel from there, at least the southern parts of Bethlehem and Jerusalem. Herod wanted to keep a watchful eye on his friends and on his enemies. What about watchfulness? We cannot afford to be naive while we're living in Babylon about our friends and enemies. And that's what this text is about today as we finish our series on 1 Peter, Exiles in Babylon. Actually, the word watchfulness or watchful only appears one time in the passage that we'll read today. But the spirit of watchfulness is kind of all over this text, which is why I kind of want to reduce it to this sentence this morning. And it's this, that the exiles, humble leaders and followers, are watchful. The exiles, humble leaders, and followers are watchful. And I want to take us with kind of my preacher's knife, slicing down through these 11 verses of chapter 5 of 1 Peter, and kind of show you what I mean by that. So if you have your Bibles or devices, turn to this first paragraph. We'll just give it this heading, and that is, watch the flock of God. Certain people in the church are charged with the responsibility of watching the flock of God. So let's take a look at it. Chapter 5 of 1 Peter, beginning in verse 1. The apostle says, "So I exhort," and that word means to beseech, to plead with. It's an earnest word. "I exhort the elders." Now, you could make an argument that Paul is just talking to, or Peter rather, talking to the elderly people in the church. Because in verse 5, he'll talk about the younger folks. And yet, when you get into the content of verses 2 and 3, it's pretty obvious. This is not just the older folks of the church. This is the elders, the shepherds, if you will, of the congregations. They're in Pontus, Galatia, Bithynia, Cappadocia, modern-day Turkey. So he says, "I exhort the elders among you." And he identifies himself in three ways. As a fellow elder. That's the only time that phrase appears in all the New Testament. And you notice that in the first part of our study, chapter 1, verse 1, Peter calls himself a capital A apostle. "I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ." He could have asserted his authority. But here, since he's talking to the elders of the church, he just kind of says, "I'm just kind of one of the guys." Peter doesn't get trapped about titles. So he says, "I'm a fellow elder and I'm a witness, a martus." Where we get our English word martyr, I can testify to what I've seen and heard as a witness of the sufferings of Christ. Think back, folks, to how many times in this book we've talked about the sufferings of Christ and how the sufferings of Christ help us go through our sufferings. And then it says, as well as a partaker, one who shares something in common in the glory that's to be revealed. Oh, one thing I like about Peter is he never gets far from the second coming of Jesus Christ. He never gets far from the return of Jesus. He says someday when he comes, we're not going to have to live in Babylon anymore. We'll get to participate in the glory that's to be revealed. And then he addresses the elders, these humble leaders. He says, "Shepherd the flock of God." Now what he does is he takes a noun and he verbs it. That's what he does. He makes it, and it is a verb, shepherd. It means to feed and to lead and to guard God's people. Shepherd the flock of God, and we are his flock. Sometimes we're good and sometimes we're bad, but we are the flock. I'm here all week. Anyway, so the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight. That's one of the other terms for elders, overseers. Any credible scholar I know says that the elders and the shepherds and the bishops or the overseers are the same people. They're the same ones. Exercising oversight. Not this way, but that way. Not this way, but he starts getting right down to the nitty-gritty of the elders' motives. Not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you. I so appreciated something Greg Hafer said last week here in the pulpit when his mama would call him to come in on Sunday afternoon to clean up, to get ready to go to church. And he would say, maybe it's the siblings as well, "Do we have to go to church?" And his mom would say, "No, we get to go to church." Same thing here. Not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you. Not for shameful gain. Excuse me? Elders in the earliest church were sometimes paid? Yeah, read 1 Timothy 5. But eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge. I keep going back to Brother Seth Wilson's statement that if all authority in heaven and earth has been given unto Jesus, how much is left over for you? Not even elders have authority. They might have effective influence, but not authority. That belongs to Jesus. Not domineering over those in charge, but being examples of the flock. The word example is the Greek word tupos. It means one over whom others can trace their lives. And then he says, and when the chief shepherd, Oh, man, with every birthday candle on the cake, I'm looking forward to this. More and more each day. The Old Testament prophets called him the true shepherd. Take a look in Ezekiel. And Jesus referred to himself as the good shepherd, John 10. And in Hebrews chapter 13, he's called the great shepherd of the sheep. Here it says, and when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive an unfading crown of glory. Do you remember from chapter 1, our inheritance that is secure, kept in heaven for you? That inheritance is unfading. Here, it's a reference to the ancient Olympic Games and how that they would give you a wreath, but it would fade. There was actually a friend of ours, a couple, that one time when I was doing some stuff down at the Academy Christian Church in Colorado Springs, Colorado, this guy took us out. It was Valentine's Day on the Wednesday night. And so he had flown in from Hawaii. What do you call them, honey? Lays? Do you know what a lay is? It smells really good for a few days. And then it like doesn't. Okay, because the flowers sort of begin to, you know how this works. But we have, Peter says, an unfading crown of glory. So what's he saying? Elders in the church, shepherds, overseers, they are to watch the flock of God. Their job consists of feeding, leading, and guarding. Feeding means to teach, leading means to equip, and guarding means to protect. And that's what you see in this passage. Shepherds of the church are not cowboys. They don't drive us. They're shepherds. They lead us. T.S. Eliot made an incredible statement. I've leaned on this at times through the years. He said this, those who serve the cause can make the cause serve them. And I've been guilty of that, thinking this revolves around me. But shepherds of the church, elders of the church, overseers of the church have to always be watchful, not of themselves, but the flock. Because you can start thinking, this is about you. Those who serve the cause have to watch it like a hawk because they can make the cause serve them. I think probably the Quaker, Philip Gully, gets at this attitude in a right way. I like this old guy. He writes several books. This is one from years gone by. It's just called Front Porch Tales. And Philip Gully is a Quaker person. And he tells several stories in this book, not the least of which I think can relate to the elders watching the flock of God. It's entitled Tasting Tears. I don't know how easy empathy wells up in your heart, but sometimes I'm an unfeeling clod. And I need help to remind myself that empathy is your pain in my heart. And so here's the story about tasting tears from Philip Gully. When my wife and I first married, we lived upstairs in an old house owned by a mortician who gave us a rent break every time I helped him bury someone. I don't know how you pray about that, but anyway, eventually they tore the house down since in America, it's easier to throw something away than to fix it. We moved into an old farmhouse with $1,000 heating bills and wraparound porches. The house sat in the middle of 500 acres of corn and beans, came with a barn, a chicken coop turned garage, and a smokehouse. Since I didn't smoke, we put our bicycles there. The house also came with a whole tribe of barn cats. One of them slipped through the screen door, unpacked its cat suitcase, and set up housekeeping. We named him Whittier after the Quaker poet and trained him to hide every time the landlord came around checking for violations. Our neighbor had a cat named Cream Rinse. How that name came into being is entirely a different story. Let me just say that it made no difference to the cat, who, like most cats, didn't come when it was called anyway. The cat I had came as a child when I called it, but only when I ran the can opener at the same time. What's more important to know is that Cream Rinse and Whittier were nearly identical in appearance, except for a small spot on Whittier's chin. We didn't have any children at the time and considered Whittier our baby. So when I was lying in the bathtub one morning and heard my wife wail and gnash her teeth, I knew something had happened to Whittier. Sure enough, there had been a feline auto encounter of the worst kind on the road in front of our house. Being the one with the burial experience, it fell to me to entomb him out back underneath the walnut tree. Except I didn't have a shovel, so I had to borrow our neighbor's at 6 o'clock in the morning, which woke her up. Being the mother of Cream Rinse, though, she was most understanding. 3 days later, I was sitting on the porch swing reading Dear Abby, parentheses, Dear Abby, I have neighbors who borrow my lawn tools at all hours of the day. What shall I do? Parentheses. And Whittier jumped in my lap, white spot and all. Resurrection, hallelujah. Turned out Whittier had gone to visit relations for a few days, and it was cream rinse that I had buried. Perhaps you're wondering how I could make such a mistake. I will simply mention that when dealing with flattened feline, one doesn't look too closely for identifying characteristics. Now came the hard part. I had to tell my neighbor it was her cat who used up his 9 lives, and I had to do it without laughing, it being unwise to chuckle while giving death notices. I learned that from my old landlord, but certain aspects of this were just so humorous that laughter sometimes slipped out, which confirmed her suspicion that I was an unfeeling clod. Turns out Cream Rinse had gotten his name from Saturday night baths, so they had a history, and she had some tears to shed. Been times I've wondered how others can be so happy when I'm miserable. Then other times I've wondered how I can smile when other folks are crying buckets. And how those little tears, what that little of those tears mean to me sometimes. Of all the traits we need to cultivate, empathy is the toughest. That's when somebody's crying, but somebody else is tasting tears. Most of us don't taste anyone's tears but our own, and we wonder why our souls dry up. So today, I aspire toward empathy for tasting tears other than my own, and I'm going to start with my neighbor, whom Jesus commanded me to love, whether she loans me her tools or not. You know what the job of elders is to do? With motives like this. Not like this, but like this, not like this, not like... That's how Peter does it. Elders are to have empathy and taste the tears of the church. That's the calling. And you know what? You can't do that unless you're watching them. Unless you watch the flock, you'll never know what tears they're having. So we watch the flock of God. But there's something else in the passage that we watch. We watch the pride of people. We watch the pride of people. Look, if you will, at verse 5. You know he's making a connection because he goes on to say, likewise, you who are younger, so this could be male or female, be subject to the elders. There's that word that had quite a bit of prominence back in chapter 2 and chapter 3. It means to voluntarily yield. Show me a person who doesn't know how to yield to older people. I will show you a kid en route to a tragedy. Be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves. Actually, it means to tack an apron on yourself, all of you, with humility toward one another. The word humility will be mentioned 3 times in this passage, and it does not mean to think ill of yourself, as I said before. It means just to not think of yourself. It means lowliness of mind. It means every day finding my place before God and others. That's what it means. With humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud. Is that in quotation marks in your Bible? But gives grace to... He's pulling that from Proverbs 3:34. And then he says, humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up higher and higher, and he will lift you up. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. And if you trace that in the concordance, you'll be back in the land of Egypt. Because that phrase is used about the Exodus, where God brought his people out with a mighty hand, so that at the proper time, he may exalt you. Now here's Mike's good song today that he sang for us. Casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. The word casting is to meaning to throw or to hurl. And the word anxieties is the normal word for worry. And the text says, because he cares for you. What does prayer have to do with humility? Everything. Because the person who doesn't pray is basically saying to God, thank you very much, I can handle this on my own. That's how it connects. Wow. So what about this? What are we to make of this? The antidote to pride is humility. We have to watch pride like a hawk, and we have to put it on every day. That's why it says, clothe yourself. Can I show you a picture of the second most famous church in the land of Israel? It's in Bethlehem in the West Bank. That's the entrance to the Church of the Nativity. And you don't get to go into this church to see the larger church building and then go down in a cave and see the supposed spot of where Mary laid baby Jesus. The only way you get into the Church of the Nativity is you gotta stoop. That's humility. That's humility. I brought with me today a thing I got from the internet, so I know it's true. It's from the regeneration people. 100+ common struggles. Anybody got any common struggles here today? And personal assessment. 117 items on this sheet of paper. Just what do you carry around every day with you? And so I thought, well, you know, I've had a few struggles in life, but I was born in a Christian home. I was raised in the church. I probably was spared a lot of things. I'm just going to take this test. May I be honest with you? You might think more ill of your preacher. I had to confess to 68 of these 117. Does that mean that I just am not following this admonition of Scripture, casting all my anxieties on the Lord because He cares for me? Am I just trying to say, thank you, I can handle this myself? Maybe that's an indication of pride. Garrison Keillor tells about the time when he was listening to a sermon in church and got bored. I don't know if he's been to Park Plaza. But he just started thinking about other things while the sermon just went on and on. And he thought about a rabbi who used to go to the Western Wall, the Wailing Wall. You remember that? People that went with us on the trip. And notice this guy, day after day, week after week, year after year, this old rabbi just kept going to the wall and writing little prayers and sticking them in the wall. And one day, one person asked the rabbi, "What do you pray about?" He said, "Oh, you know, you would guess, justice, peace, honest leaders to lead our people." And the man says, "So how's it going?" He said, "It's like talking to a stone wall." Well, it is a significant wall, I will say, and it's humbling to put your hand on it. But we don't talk to a stone wall. We talk to a God who, by His grace, has decided to listen to your puny suggestions about how to run His world. Prayer is not bending His arm. It is taking hold of His willingness. And it's the opposite of pride. So we got to watch the pride of people. There's one other item here I'd like to mention. We got to watch the enemy of the church. We got to watch the enemy of the church. Look what he goes on to say here in beginning in verse 8. He says, "Be sober-minded." And clearly he's talking about a drunken situation, but applied to your brain. Be sober-minded. Sobriety of mind. Be watchful. There's the only time in the text that it appears. But if you do a concordance study on that word, you will see that most often it is associated with the return of Jesus Christ. It is an eschatological term. We're always watching while we're out in our garden, hoeing. We got one eye cast toward the eastern sky, watching for His return. Be watchful. Your adversary, and it does literally mean anti-dikos. It means the person who stands against righteousness. The adversary, the devil, diabolos, the one who lies, prowls around like a roaring lion. Can we just stay with that image for just a moment? Do you know they called Nero a lion? Is this a veiled reference? Probably not, since it's identifying as the devil. But it tells us that he's seeking someone to devour. Resist him. It means to stand opposite him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kind of sufferings are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. There is a strange solidarity that helps us stand against the enemy when we realize we're not the only ones. We're not the only ones. And after you have suffered a little while, that's the same thing he said in chapter 1. While the grace of God, who has called you His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself restore you. The word katartizo means to fix a broken bone. It means a ship that's now at port that will be repaired. Confirm you, strengthen you, establish you. To Him be dominion forever and ever. Amen. Do you see why we have to hold our friends and our enemies closer? We don't want to be naive living in Babylon for sure. Because this lion bids us no good. Have you seen a lion stalk its prey? Have you watched the National Geographic videos of this kind of thing? Let me just run one for you. If you can sort of multitask in this, I'll save you the blood and gore. But here's the interesting thing. Not only historical reference about Nero, but there's two lions in the Bible. May I remind you? One lion is this one, seeking whom he may devour. He bids us no good. He is the enemy of the faith. He is our adversary, called by 21 different names in Scripture. That's why he's so hard to recognize sometimes. No, but there is another lion in the Bible. He is the lion of the tribe of Judah. And when he shows up, this lion is like a kitty cat. Doesn't stand a prayer. Let us not be naive in our watchfulness about this particular one. And sometimes, if I could circle back, even elders go belly up about not being watchful. There's a guy by the name of Polycarp, who was a disciple of the Apostle John, who, when he wrote a letter to the Philippians, now that's not the one in your Bible, but he wrote a letter to the Philippians, and he refers to an elder in the church there by the name of Valens, V-A-L-E-N-S, and he says he ensconced, he basically stole money from the church. Maybe that's why he says elders don't do this for selfish, shameful gain, but for other things. Well, what are we saying today? I suppose I could have one more idea. Because verse 1 talks about his glory being revealed. Verse 11 says, to him be glory. The other thing besides the enemy and pride and the flock that we have to watch is for his return. He's coming back. And you know what? When he comes again, we won't have to live in Babylon anymore. There'll be no more death or mourning or pain, for the old order thing will be passed away and all things will be new, and we'll hear a voice from the throne say, behold, I make all things new. Someday. Oh man, I don't know what you've thought about our little study, Exiles in Babylon, through this book, but this book talks about our wonderful salvation. That's our inheritance kept in heaven, guarded by God. This book talks about how, therefore, we're to be holy as God is holy. This book calls us to be living stones built into a spiritual house. This book calls us to know how to submit to government institutions and in the home and in society. And this book tells us how to suffer the right way and how to not let our Christian service go on the back burner because of that suffering, and how that under the name of Christ we bring glory to God by suffering. And then this last emphasis day, to watch and to watch and to watch. I'm so glad that someday we don't have to live in Babylon anymore. You would recognize the name Charles de Gaulle, World War II, famous French soldier, statesman, author, Charles de Gaulle. He and his wife Yvonne had a very special needs child, very, very disabled. Doctor said she would not last long. And every night when Charles and Yvonne would put their daughter to bed, Yvonne would say, oh, why can't she be like the others? She did come to her end. She passed away. They escorted, of course, Charles and Yvonne and the family to the gravesite where their little daughter would be buried. And as the service concluded at the gravesite, the priest had said his benediction and they were moving away from the grave, and Yvonne stayed back. Charles recognized she wasn't by him, and she turned around and he went back to his wife. And she said, oh, Charles, why can't she be like the others? And Charles said to his wife, Yvonne, didn't you hear what the priest said? She is like the others now. So let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Oh, kind Father, we love you. We say it with our lips. Help us to live it out in our lives. We pray, Lord, that we'd be faithful while we're living in this world that's so different than the one in which we were born. Please help us, sustain us. We want to cast all of our anxieties on you. We're so grateful you care for us and that we can have peace in the midst of our storms. Dismiss us with your blessing in Christ's name.